kind of watershed that after which nothing looked the same, after which anything and everything was possible.
What I would like to do is to have a giant concert.
Soon we'd be learning and the lesson today is how to die.
And he was the last person you could imagine who would put together an event as conscious as Live Aid. In the early 70s, we didn't venture any further than O'Connell Street. Came from this place, this just grey, concrete, lower middle class ghetto of non-culture. The thing I remember mostly about growing up is violence. Well, I was just beaten up every day of the week. We couldn't get served in most pubs. Weird thing was, we threatened blokes so much, but girls loved us. I tell you, it's a very, very cool thing. Wear a dress and every girl will love you, you know? He always dressed like he was from Mars, and skinheads and boot boys used to find that a real affront. Out of that came Lipton Village. Lipton Village was our revenge on the arse that we felt very arrogantly that we were growing up with. Because that's what you do, you pretend you're better. So, for instance, we knew more about music, or we knew more about what was going on. That was our defense mechanism.
Lipton Village just came out of nowhere. I mean, it was just a group of like 8-9 blokes that saw things differently. It was actually quite humorous. It was almost like sort of a Lord of the Flies in Ballymun, you know? We all had roles. I was in charge of being in charge. Googie was in charge of ignorance. Bono was judge and jury. Like, if we walked into a room, we'd command the attention visually, and Bono could do it differently. He had that charisma from word go.
I think people, you know, tend to define you two according to the Joshua Tree and the kind of emotional openness and the direct appeal that you two had in that phase. But they began as a very theatrical group with Bono acting out various characters. His onstage persona was very consciously theatrically based, and quite a bit of that would have been to do with the influence that the Prunes would have had on you two.
I think when the punk thing happened in 76, and we all sort of found out that we could form bands, that you didn't actually have to know many chords, you could just get away with two chords, and you could borrow drum kits, and you could write your own lyrics. It sort of demystified the whole thing, because we thought it was all about Rory Gallagher and Van Morrison, who were like serious musos.
The cat was out of the bag in some ways culturally. You know, Ireland, a country which had been quite closed for so many years, was really starting to open up for the first time. And I think, certainly from our point of view, getting into a band was just a great way of sort of getting out.
Mediocrity is rampant in Ireland, and the last thing I want to be is one of the lumpen majority. I despise the common lot, and when you walk down the street, you should strive to be different to everybody else. And rock and roll is about excitement, that's all it's about, and that excitement is in the way you look, and the way you think, and the way you play, and the way you feel. And if any of those ingredients is missing, it's not rock and roll, man.
I didn't know
released War in 1983. It already had a top 10 hit in Britain with New Year's Day. And when the album went straight in to the top of the charts, which was the first time that had ever happened with an Irish act, it was clear that they had arrived. In fact, they were a major force
in rock and roll worldwide by the time Bob Geldof came up with his next scheme. If you remember, in the mid-80s, Live Aid, which was born out of a humanitarian impulse, provoked some conflicting responses, and understandably so, because it was never going to solve the problem of starvation in Africa.
But as the last person you could imagine who would put together an event as conscious as Live Aid.
Of course, from an Irish perspective, it was a huge day for U2.
When Geldof called up and said, there's going to be a gig, I said, just tell me where it is and what time we're on, we'll be there.
And now, a group whose heart is in Dublin, Ireland, a group that's never had any problem saying how they feel, U2.
I remember the Live Aid show very well. I remember it very clearly because I really felt when we came off stage that we'd really blown it. I thought that it was a kind of botched attempt at creating a moment.
Everyone had an allotted amount of time, and I think we were supposed to do three songs. On the day, I think we were all very shocked because Bono dumped the script, headed off into the crowd. The band didn't know where he was half the time. I was on stage, I couldn't see what he was doing either. And we thought he'd blown it. In fact, nothing could have been further from the truth. He had figured out what the rest of us hadn't realized, which was that it was a TV show. There might have been 80,000 people in the stadium, but the really important audience was to be reached through the television cameras. And his performance that day was quite extraordinary.
U2 had done a vast amount of groundwork, touring Europe and the States in particular, so they'd created a momentum. But after the performance on Live Aid, their albums began to sell in unprecedented numbers. The 80s had begun with wide-scale unemployment and the Irish economy in tatters. The rock musicians who emerged as successes during that period really did so against the run of the play. So when U2 and Clannad and later Enya came surging through, and when Geldof ran the Live Aid extravaganza with such presence, the sense of confidence which resulted, especially from U2's success, was literally like a shot in the arm.
Thank you. God bless you.
Basically, the feeling was, if they can do it, why can't we?
How gung-ho he was. Of course, Philip had just gone to bed, and I can't remember what Philip said to him. It was a few versions of "F off." But he actually was quite sweet to him at the same time. Philip was the business.
That whole use of what I suppose have been known as, come to be known as, kind of Celtic harmonies, if you like, that ethereal use of the voice. The multi-layered.
Yes. U2 was the kind of watershed that, after which nothing looked the same, after which anything and everything was possible.
The one thing that I found when I worked with the band in the studio was the fact that there really were no rules. A lot of us who were older, we were probably hidebound a little bit by the sort of framework that seemed to be imposed upon us. You two didn't seem to notice that. You It was new and it was fresh, and it clearly was going to be something which, if we could keep some of that energy at home, that was going to be some rocket fuel that could get a lot of people out of Ireland. First of all, it created an environment where new technical skills could grow, and that was very important. And not alone were the technical skills important, but also the whole support skills, you know, that came through administration, understanding of what music publishing was about, understanding what management was about, how it worked, what putting a band on the road was about.
Thank you for joining us live on the air.
My pleasure.
The importance of this to the generation of a kind of national musical confidence can't be overrated.
It was a place where everything was legal.
Suddenly there was traffic, you know, whereas before there was nothing. There was just a boreen out of Ireland down which people walked and they never returned.
I think it was crucial, fundamental. It was the first band that sort of, that kind of said, right, we're going to do it from here. And that cannot be overestimated, how important that was and how empowering that was, to use the modern buzzword.
The great thing about being in Dublin for us was we were close enough, an hour away from Island Records in London, but we were far enough away for them not to get too bothersome. I think definitely it did us no harm to be Irish. And Bono used to, there was something he used to say on stage. He used to say, we are not just another English band passing through. For a start, we're Irish and we're going to be back.
Said, I think Paul McGinnis and U2 created the Irish music industry. Certainly wasn't there before that. So that's basically what I'm saying.
I think that of all the performers and that, Bono is he's definitely the most powerful personality. He just has that you feel he's never on full throttle.
The way he dresses and, you know, the way he has different personas. Just stuff like, you know, the devil outfit.
Look what you've done to me.
You know, he's taken a lot, I think, in terms of his clothes and what he wears and everything from the show band kind of era. You're probably killing me for saying that.
Listened to an awful lot, and I would have paid most attention to, and they would definitely have influenced me to be in a band myself.
One of the most positive changes which has become apparent during the course of the 90s is the old Dublin rural divide has been washed away. You've studios all over the country. You've musicians and bands north, south, east and west who've come through and made an impact. And there's a great diversity to it. Brian Kennedy from West Belfast, Therapy from Larne, Westlife from Sligo, Sinead Lowen from Cork, Martin Hayes, who's a wonderful fiddle player from Clare. You know, the list is endless, really. Success would be the Cranberries from Limerick, who sold a massive number of albums.